listen to the radio. That's where I wanna be. On an old park bench in the middle of December, cold hard rain falling, can't find no cover. That would be alright with me. Hard days, good times, blue skies, dark nights, baby, I want you to take me wherever you're going to.
Words of Bon Jovi, hard days, good times, blue skies, dark nights. The richness of human experience involves each of these types of things. Hard days, good times, blue skies, dark nights. Today may well be one of those hard days, but as we gather here to honour Jovie Jean Dolly Manning, we come together because in her short life she enjoyed many good times. And because despite the dark nights which life inevitably brings, she has taught us that we can and should continue to look up and give thanks for blue skies. My name is Simon and I'm proud to say that I'm Jovie's uncle, Deb's big brother. And this may well be a difficult afternoon for many of us. Jovie's passing, the loss of that courageous bundle of life, is of course hard to deal with, hard to comprehend. But here we are. Many of us, most of us, all of us almost, dressed in yellow, not in black, in recognition not only that this is Jovie's colour, but because her very presence brightened up our lives. It is possible to smile and to be thankful for that truth, even as the tears run down our cheeks. Hard days, good times, blue skies, dark nights. As we gather to remember this afternoon, in this space, in this time, both crying and smiling are permitted, and that's true for those of you watching on the live stream as well. As we begin, however, we're going to spend a few moments in silence, recognising this day is especially hard for those who have been closest to Jovie. As I mention the names of these people, I invite you, in a way that you feel comfortable, with your thoughts or in a silent prayer, to surround them with your love. So as we remember Jovie, we remember that she's the daughter of Debs and Chris, the sister of Court, Demi Lee, Aubrey, Tallulah, Sophia, Rue, and Keen, the great-granddaughter of Sylvia and Mick, the granddaughter of Charles and Judith, Glenn and Julie, Des and Carol, the cousin and niece to many, a little friend to Arthur and Bonnie and Edie and Bobby and Rafe and Emily, goddaughter to Shelley, and like a member of the family for Hannah and Grant, special friends, particularly over the last year. May they and we find love and comfort, hope and healing this day and in the days and weeks to come. Do continue to surround Chris and Debs with your love now as they come forward and celebrate Jovie's life with their own tribute to her and those who have been part of her journey.
I guess we knew this day would come, but we always kept hope that it wouldn't. But we stand here with a whole pregnancy and a whole 1 year and 11 days worth of memories. That's 376 incredible days that we had with our daughter. Living and breathing on this earth, and we certainly made every one of them count.
Jovie went to the zoo, the farm and the circus. She went to the park, fed the ducks, swung on the swings and went down the slide. Jovie went camping, on holiday and to the beach. She went pumpkin picking and dressed up for Halloween. She met Father Christmas, went to a Christingle and hung her stocking on the fireplace. She enjoyed play dates with friends and loved her sessions at Top Cats. Jovie was adored by all of her siblings, who made sure she was never short of a cuddle, and she was inseparable from her new puppy. She enjoyed a messy 6-month birthday cake smash with Arthur and Hunter, and had an amazing first birthday and party, played Pass the Parcel and blew the candles out on her cake.
And Jovie loved the water. Having been born in the water, you would think this would be quite the norm. But after her first bath in NICU, where she screamed and screamed, we were unsure if this would be the case. But going swimming in a warm, bubbly bath soon became her favourite thing. Most days, Jovie would have 2, 3, or even 4 baths a day, if she was really milking it, some at even 3 a.m. Being pampered princess that Mummy made her, they would always follow with a massage and a relaxing hairbrush, her next favourite things. And then Mummy's favourite thing, choosing an outfit and an elaborate bow for the day. Jovie had a bow for every occasion. And let me assure you, she isn't going to a resting place without one in her hair.
Saturdays were her time to go and watch Daddy and her yellows play football. Quite a fitting colour for her favourite team. Jovie certainly was their lucky mascot, as since she started going to their games, they have never played so well. Reaching highs in the cup and being undefeated winners of the league. Daddy even managed to score a few goals. though it didn't do Mummy's anxiety much good with a few near misses of the football. With Chris as her daddy, Jovie had no choice but to love sport. As most of you know, Jovie was pretty much nocturnal, and when it was daddy's turn to take over the night shift, it meant cricket and cuddles all the way. Sometimes a bit of AFL or the Winter Olympics was always a winner too. She would get comfy laying back on daddy's belly and take it all in. If Jovie could have talked, I'm sure sport would have been her choice of topic. As you have heard, and as we all know, Jovie has never liked to follow the rules. Her song choice would always be Lady Gaga over a lullaby. And in pregnancy, when she was being stubborn and not moving much for us, an episode of Sons of Anarchy would sort her right out.
Back then, our pregnancy memories were all we ever thought we would have. And we were still grateful for every day of those. So we want to take this moment to truly thank Jovie. Thank you, Jovie, for every second you've given to us. For teaching us strength within ourselves we never knew existed. Thank you for teaching kindness to everyone you met and filling our hearts with a love like no other. Thank you for making us and your brothers and sisters better people. Thank you for giving us the best year of our lives and enough happy memories to carry us through what is now going to be our hardest part of our life. Thank you for your fighting spirit, your strength and your resilience. Even through the tough bits you showed us, you were a true Manning girl and just got on with it, or just fell asleep. Thank you for being perfectly you and impacting this world in a short life in a way others could only dream of doing.
Thank you for choosing us to be your mummy and daddy. There are some other extra special people in this room that we would like to thank who went above and beyond. There is an African proverb that says, it takes a village to raise a child. Well, Jovie's village was a little different, but by far the best team she could have ever asked for.
Rachel, our fatal medicine midwife that got us through the pregnancy. You were incredible. Somehow, and I don't know how, but despite all the bad news you had to keep delivering to us, you made it okay. You showed us that you believed in Jovie and you believed in us. Even when your professional role had come to an end with us, you remained in our lives, and we still never forget your advocacy for Jovie. I like to think that day Jovie pooed on all over your lap was her way of saying thank you to you too.
Heidi. Our hypnobirthing instructor, empowering us to believe in ourselves, teaching us to ask the right questions, and guiding us to positivity when sometimes it felt there wasn't any, which resulted in us having the perfect birth, and we truly believe the reason why Jovie came out breathing. I like to think of you as our gift from Jovie, a friend we never knew we needed, but one I know we can't do without. Molly, you can blame Heidi for your headstrong customers that walked into your delivery room that day. You embraced our craziness, believed in my ability to birth Jovie the way I wanted, and despite the resistance from other professionals, you had my back the whole time. Because of you, we had the most perfect birth and the most precious time with our daughter after birth. Memories that will stay with us forever. Sarah, our NICU mum, you don't just need a thank you, you need a medal for putting up with Chris for 5.5 weeks. Time in NICU is tough, but you made it much easier. From wiping our tears, listening to our rants, and helping us to plan our escape, we couldn't have got through it without you. And your later visits to the ward when Jovie was in hospital brought very much needed cuddles.
Nick, the best and most down-to-earth consultant we could ever ask for, to take care of our daughter. We want you to know that respecting our knowledge as Jovie's parents and talking to us like we were all part of the same team didn't go unnoticed. You may think the way you were is general practice for most, but believe us when we tell you it sadly isn't. Your empathy, your patience, and your ability to counsel a somewhat emotional mother were second to none. and you never made us feel that any amount of crazy middle-of-the-night emails, there was a lot, were too much. And our inappropriate time banter between us all kept us smiling. You never gave up on Jovie, and for that we will always be internally grateful.
Megan, someone who knows the importance of a good cup of tea. I don't actually know your professional title, but I do know you are an asset to Norfolk and Norwich Hospital, and one I hope that they treasure. You have been there through lots of Jovie's hospital admissions, and even if you weren't looking after us, you would pop in to say hello and would always make us smile. We saw a lot of people in different hospitals, but you were different, and I hope you realise how special you are. I am so thankful it was you.
Shelley, the one that kept it all together, continuously going above and beyond, the very reason that Jovie lived her miraculous 376 days. There are no words to describe how amazing you are. That is why when you finished your role as Jovie's community nurse, we had to ask you to be her godmother. There will never be enough thank yous for you. We love you.
The team at Each. We always knew of your support through Jovie's life, and we are grateful to have had you as part of the team. But our thanks goes to the incredible hospitality you gave us at the end, allowing us the time and the space to process what was happening. The memories your charity enabled us to create are something that will stay with us forever, and the support you gave us at the hardest time in our lives will never be forgotten. There are so many people that contributed to Jovie's life along the way, and we are so thankful we have the amazing NHS. But you were all more than you ever had to be. We honestly believe that without each one of you, we would have been standing here much earlier than we are today. So from the bottom of our hearts, thank you.
We have invited you all here today, not just to mourn a life that has been lost, but to celebrate a life that got gained and a life that was lived to the full. And not just Jovie's life. We know that Jovie made a difference to each and every one of you in this room and to thousands of more across the globe. Everyone that met Jovie just fell in love with her, not just with her beautiful hair and her lovely long eyelashes, but with her warmth, her amazing soul and her fighting spirit. She touched people in a way that we can't explain, and she brought out people's kindness in abundance. It's hard to imagine how one little girl can make such an impact on a big wide world, but she did, and we know she will continue to do so for years to come.
Like we have always said, please don't be sorry for us, for we are not sorry. We are not sorry we got to be the parents to the most incredible little girl. No time would have ever been enough for us with our darling daughter. But it was enough time for her to change the world.
Amazing parents, and as Debs and Chris sat down, I want to say thank you to them on your behalf. The two of you, we want to pay tribute to the people that you are. As you've paid tribute to the people that were companions to you and Jovie on her journey, but you were the ones that realised that Jovie had a story to tell. You were the ones who enabled her to tell it. In the choices that you made, in the way that you opened your hearts to the world, choosing to share the joys and the challenges of Jovie's life, the milestones and the heartaches, the football matches and the sleepless nights, the hugs and the play dates. Yes, Jovie was writing her own story, but you were the ones that shared her story with the world. We thank you, Chris. We thank you, Debs. And Debs, one of the ways you shared that was with poetry written in the middle of the night. I don't know how you managed to write such beautiful poems with so little sleep. But you're also a photographer. And we've heard how Jovie was a Lady Gaga sort of girl. And so as we listen to a little bit of Lady Gaga, we're going to look at some of those photographs now, memories that you and others were so able to beautifully capture.
Butter is on the sky, burning in your eyes. at me, babe, I wanna catch on fire. It's buried in my soul, like California gold. You found the light in me that I couldn't find. So when I'm all choked up but I can't find the words, every time we say goodbye, baby, it hurts. When the sun goes down and the band won't play, I'll always remember us this way. Lovers in the night, though it's trying to ride, we don't know how to rhyme, but damn, we try. But all I really know, you're where I wanna go. The part of me that you will never die. So when I'm all choked up and I can't find the words, every time we say goodbye, baby, it hurts. When the sun goes down and the band won't play, I'll always remember us this way.
Some powerful photographs, a powerful song, all for a powerful little lady. Jovie, not Gaga, that is. There's a line at the beginning of that song that says this: you found the light in me that I couldn't find. Some people might look at the vulnerable and fragile life that Jovie lived and miss something. Something that has, in fact, great power. Something that has the potential to make a great impact on those who encounter it. Someone who lights up our lives in a way that few others have. In a way, we continue with that theme now. You may already know, or you may have already begun to notice, that as well as the colour yellow, Jovie's journey, both her life and the charity of that name that Chris and Debs have set up, have become associated with an animal, the elephant. And it's appropriate that elephants never forget, and Jovie's life is one that we will always remember. And so Heidi, who you heard being mentioned earlier, Deb's hypnobirthing instructor, is going to come up now and read us a beautiful story about an elephant.
Okay, elephant me. Elephant Mighty reclined on his throne at the start of the elephant games. Impress me, he said to the little ones there, and I'll give you your elephant names. Tradition dictated in elephant lore that all of the young ones compete and try to be better than everyone else at a certain spectacular feat. And each time an elephant managed to prove a talent or skill to the king, the monarch would give him his elephant name, an honour they all longed to win. Nina was first to try out for a name, the largest young elephant there. She pulled a whole tree from the ground by its roots and lifted it high in the air. "Amazing," cried Elephant Mighty. "Hurrah! Your trunk is so splendid and long. I never imagined that tree would come loose. I'm calling you Elephant Strong." Young Norcus was next, so he took a deep breath and summoned all of his might. He let out a bellow so loud and so shrill that even the vultures took flight. "Remarkable," Elephant Mighty declared. "That sound, it could set off a riot. I'm calling you Elephant Noisy, my boy. Now shush, settle down and be quiet." One by one, all the young elephants came and showed off the things they could do. And each one was awarded its elephant name, except one at the back of the queue. "I see one more elephant hiding away. Come, show yourself now," said the king. "Yes, tell me what marvellous trick you can do. Please demonstrate. What is your thing?" "I'm not really sure yet, Your Highness," he said. "It's just that I don't really know." "Oh, nonsense," said Elephant Mighty. "What tosh? Get on with it. Give me a show." So Num Num stepped forward and did a few tricks. He was trying as hard as he could, but Elephant Mighty was most unimpressed, asking, "Can't you do anything good?" "Oh dear," scowled the king. "No, that really won't do." Poor Num Num felt hopelessly small. "I should call you Elephant Nothing," he laughed. "Yes, Elephant Nothing at all." So Num Num decided to move far away, to a place where no elephants go. He trudged through the dust and the heat of the plains, his head and his tail hanging low. But soon, because Num Num was gentle and kind and was blessed with a generous soul, lions and zebra, giraffes and gazelle came and shared his new watering hole. Then one day a warthog asked, "Why are you here?" So Num Num explained what occurred. "That's nonsense," a crocodile swiftly replied, and his friends all agreed that's absurd. "You're good at all sorts of things, really you are. You're friendly, you're kind and you're true. Out of all the animals here on these plains, there's only one you." "Come, follow me, Num Num," the crocodile said. "Let's take you back where you belong. And tell Mr. Elephant Thingy-Majig that he's not only foolish but wrong." The animals led Num Num back to his home, where Elephant Mighty held sway. "Excuse me, Your Highness," said Num Num. "It's me. And this time I've got something to say." He cleared his throat nervously and took a deep breath, then looked up as brave as can be. "I'll tell you my name," Num Num said. "I want to be Elephant Me." "You want to be Elephant Me?" sneered the king with a haughty and arrogant snort. "There's nothing about it that says what you do. That's a really ridiculous thought." "It's not," Num Num said, "because that's who I am. I may not be noisy or tough, but the hardest thing sometimes is just to be you. And to know being you is enough." To all the creatures' astonished surprise, the king didn't bellow or shout. No, Elephant Mighty had started to weep, and a long, lonely wail came out. You're right, cried the monarch. It's hard to be you. And guess what? It's hard to be me. I'm tired being Elephant Mighty all day. I want to be elephant free. I'm longing to do all those things that I can't, that a king's not expected to do, like dancing all night beneath only the stars, with my feet getting wet in the dew. Who cares about all those ridiculous names? No, what's more important by far is just to be true to ourselves every day and content with whoever we are. Elephant me, what a wonderful thing. Now, whenever we see there's a chance, let's celebrate meanness with all of our hearts. And right now, I see stars. Let's dance.
Thank you, Heidi. Who cares about all of these ridiculous names? No, what's more important by far is just to be true to ourselves every day and content with whoever we are. Jovie was able to be exactly who she was created to be, and she lived fully her Jovie-shaped life. And in doing so, she changed people's lives and had the sort of impact on the world that many of us would aspire to have. Shelley, who's going to come up now and say a few words and read a short poem, is just one example of the impact that Jovie had, about the transformation that she's brought in many of our lives. Shelley, who started out as an outreach nurse, encountered Jovie and her story and ended up being Jovie's godmum. Shelley.
I first met Jovie, Deborah and Chris on the 7th of April last year via a Teams meeting so we could plan for Jovie going home. Little did I know what an amazing journey this would take us all on. Jovie and her family have taught us all so much. They have changed our own personal thoughts and our values and have impacted on how we provide care, make decisions and work together as a team. I'm sure I can speak on my colleagues' behalf when I say what an inspiration you have been to us all. We have all become better doctors, nurses and midwives because of you. But my journey didn't stop there. And on the 12th of March, I was given the honour by being asked to be Jovie's godmother. To say I was overwhelmed at being asked is just an understatement. And I felt a deep privilege and pride to play such an important role. Jovie, although your time with us was short, you gave so much to so many. And so I'd like to read the following poem that I found that reminds me of you. She wrote a life she loved on the leaves of many books, documenting all the details so that one day she could look back at all the things she had done and all that she had seen, all the people she had known and all the places she had been. And there upon the paper, her treasures line by line, imbued with emotion, invoke moments in time. So although this was a story only she could tell, the ink left upon her pages said, my word, she lived it well.
I think it's worth repeating those words, Shelley. Thank you for them. So although this was a story that only she could tell, the ink left upon her pages said, my word, she lived it well. She did indeed. And now it's time to see some more photos of that well-lived life and to listen to another song, There You'll Be by Faith Hill.
In my dreams, I always see you soar above the sky.
I did say at the beginning it was okay to cry, didn't I? Some words from that song. When I think back, I'll be glad, because I was blessed to get you. I was blessed to get to have you in my life. Someone once said that grief is the price of love. We cry because we love, and love is good. We're coming towards the end of our service now, and on your way out, there's going to be an opportunity to take some Jovie's Journey wristband, so do take one if you want. There's also a memory book for you to write something in. That memory book will be going on later, but if you aren't able to join the family afterwards, then please do write something in it here before you leave. In addition, there's collection boxes for any donations that you have for each or for Top Cats. But you can also continue to send those to Gordon Barber if you can't do that today. One final reminder that you are warmly invited to join Chris and Debs and the family afterwards for food and refreshments at the Hotel Victoria, where we'll continue to celebrate Jovie's miraculous life. And I call it a miraculous life because, as a Christian, when I look at Jovie's life, short as it was, I catch a glimpse of the character and the love of God. Intentionally, this hasn't been a religious service, but when I shared with Chris and Debs an image of my faith that's been bringing me comfort, they were happy for me to share it with you. We all need to choose for ourselves what we believe and who we follow, but there are those like Jovie who don't live to an age where they're able to make that choice. And there's a story in the Bible where Jesus is surrounded by crowds of people, and the young children are pushing forwards to get to see him, and the adults are trying to stop them. And Jesus says this: "Let the little children come to me, and do not get in their way, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." However you imagine heaven to be, for me, part of that image now is seeing Jesus with Jovie on his knee. And she's sitting there with her amazing hair and her big eyes and her beautiful smile. And all around her are these other little friends whose life on earth was so fleeting. And Jesus is saying, "Let the little children come to me, and don't get in their way, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." There's some other ancient wisdom which compares our earthly life to a seed. I don't know if you've ever thought about the seed and the miracle that it is. In this packet are some sunflower seeds. Within each seed is an amazing, beautiful plant. The beautiful sunflower that you can see on the order of service and on this envelope. Sunflower seeds are amazing. Sunflowers are awesome. The only way that a flower can grow is for the seed to be planted, for the seed to be buried or scattered, for it to be hidden for a while before its full glory can be seen. Jovie's earthly life, her seed, was amazing. But Jovie's heavenly existence, her sunflower, will be awesome. And Jovie has planted seeds in our lives, seeds of love and kindness that she's scattered generously in our hearts. And now it's up to us to nurture those seeds of gratitude that help us to find joy in the blue skies, even after dark nights. Those seeds of courage that enable us to live our lives as fully as she did. Those seeds of love. There are plenty of these packets of seeds on the way out for you to take one each, perhaps one per family. There's a lot of people here. Take them and plant them. And when you see them turn into beautiful flowers, remember Jovie. Remember the seed that she's sown in our lives. And maybe even take the seeds from the sunflower once it's grown and plant them again next year and give them to friends and family and neighbours and anyone who'll take one and listen and keep remembering Jovie, keep telling her story. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand as we listen to a short farewell song, and then afterwards, we'll take our seats again and we'll take our time and listen to a closing song. And then once the family have gone, please do feel free to make your own way out too. And so we come to our time of farewell. And Debs and Chris, I think you wanted a couple of moments to... We give thanks for a life well lived. We give thanks for the light that she brought to so many lives. We give thanks and celebrate the life of Jovie Jean Dolly Manning. If you are able, can I please ask you to stand now as we listen to You Are My Sunshine.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. The other night, dear, as I lay sleeping, I dreamed I held. Thank you. it look like in heaven? Is it peaceful? Is it free like they say? Does the sun shine bright forever? Have your fears and your pain gone away? 'Cause here on earth it feels like everything good is missing since you left.
Since you arrived.